thedailymass.com. Experience the Roman Catholic Mass from historic St. Louis Cathedral every day on thedailymass.com. His love, anywhere in the world.
Good evening, I'm Sarah McDonald.
And I'm Jason Angelette. Welcome to Issues in Faith.
Well, this weekend is the National Day of Prayer for Vocations.
And beautiful.
And Archbishop Amen will celebrate the Special Vocations Mass that we have annually at St. Louis Cathedral at 11 a.m. on Sunday. But also he has asked all parishes to include prayers for vocations to the priesthood and religious life, diaconate even, in their Masses this weekend. It's so important for us to remember to pray for new vocations, but also those who are serving in their vocation as well.
Definitely as a family to pray. We try to every day to have these prayers together as a family, and my own prayers, just praying specifically for vocations and how important it is to also pray for seminarians, those who are going through that process,
right.
And also for the novices and those who are going into the permanent,
religious life, diaconate.
Yeah, exactly.
That's right. And we will have both the transitional diaconate ordination and the priesthood ordination coming up the end of May and beginning of June. We have four men who are hopefully, God willing, be ordained to the priesthood in June. It's the largest class we've had, excuse me, in the Archdiocese of New Orleans. And I know that doesn't sound like a lot in four, but when you go from having one, two, to have four is wonderful.
Yeah, that's fantastic.
And we also have, I believe, six transitional deacons to be ordained this year. So our Archbishop Amen's goals and work to increase the number of local vocations seems to be bearing some fruit.
Praise God.
So, but as we talk about vocations to the priesthood and religious life, we also need to be very aware of praying for the vocation of marriage and for those of us that have the vocation that we are always working to better and still our marriages spiritually. And you have a Faith in Marriage retreat coming up this weekend.
That's right. I mean, marriage is so key to all. The future of the church, the future of the society, it all hinges upon the foundation and the support of the marriage. I mean, Pope John Paul II said that his family, his mom and dad, he's called it the domestic seminary.
Yeah.
Not only to the domestic church, but the domestic seminary. So how important it was for his parents to have that faith and to live that faith. And so it encourages and calls us all out to make sure that, especially as spouses, that we're living out our first vocation authentically according to the way and the plan that God has in store. And that path actually leads us to the fulfillment that our hearts are longing for. So many times in marriages we try to do other things or fill it with other activities and whatnot and missions, other goals, other our own will. But when we surrender to God's will, that opens the door to that stability, that success. You know, in the Psalms, unless the Lord builds the house, they labor in vain who build. And marriages are that house that we need to labor, and we need to labor with the Lord in it. And so that we have that strong foundation to where, like in Matthew, where the winds and the rains come, it has a strong foundation. It doesn't fall because we listen and we act on the words of the builder. So, but we have a retreat coming up, and a way to kind of help strengthen the family and strengthening marriages. A married couples retreat is a wonderful opportunity, regardless of whether the couple's been married for, you know, a newly married 1 or 2 years to 52 plus years. It's just an opportunity for grace, for prayer, for renewing. I find it's important for my marriage, and I see it impacting many marriages. I feel personally that I think every married couple should have at least once a year go on a married couples retreat, just like the vocations to the priesthood and the diaconate.
Mm-hmm.
They have their mandatory yearly retreat that they have to take. I truly feel that if married couples did an annual retreat, it would make an impact dramatically in their marriage and their family. So we have a retreat coming up the 28th and 29th of April, and then we also have another retreat back-to-back.
That's right.
The 5th and the 6th of May.
And you still have registrations open for the May?
Registrations are open. You can go to the website faithinmarriage.org and you can learn more about that, or call me on the office line 504-830-3716. We can answer any questions. But the beauty is that we have these retreats around the calendar, and we also have a special retreat in November where we're actually asking not only the mom and dad, the husband and wife, to come on the retreat, but we're asking their teenage children to come on the retreat.
Wow.
And what we're going to do is, and this is all through the work of the Archbishop Amon, wanting this to happen, that what we're going to do is we're going to have a married couples retreat, and then at the same time at Camp Abbey, the teenagers will have a retreat with Dumb Ox Productions.
Mm.
And so we're going to team up on Sunday. The Archbishop's going to come and have a family retreat on that Sunday.
That's
so
amazing.
It's going to be an amazing weekend for an opportunity for growth for the family, growth for marriage, and an impact in our church. So I think it's going to be amazing.
And that is important. And for those of us that may not be able to make, or viewers who may not be able to make the marriage retreats, it's important to do those little things throughout the week. Pray together.
Exactly.
Go to Mass as a family together.
Yes.
It's always challenging. I know I have a little one. It's
yes.
challenging sometimes to get to Mass as a family, but make that effort.
Amen.
It's not only good for you two together to be praying and partaking in the Mass and that ultimate sacrament together, but for you to be the example to your children of why going to Mass is important.
John Paul II said that prayer, the Eucharist, and the sacrament of penance are the means infallible and indispensable to forming the Christian spirituality of conjugal and family life. So for mom and dad to be mom and dad and to be husband and wife and to be the family, at the very foundation, the means that are infallible and indispensable, building prayer, going to receive the Eucharist, and receiving the great graces that come to us in the sacrament of confession.
Well, thank you, Jason, for sharing that.
Praise
and for
God.
Working with you and your wife together, working
Amen.
To put the marriage retreats together
Praise
for
God.
Our community and beyond.
Praise God.
Well, when we come back, we'll speak with Monsignor James Maroney about his upcoming workshops. This is Issues in Faith on LAE.
What will the world ask of them? Whatever it is, they'll be prepared to answer. Because in a safe and disciplined environment, Louisiana Catholic schools shape tomorrow's leaders. Catholic students are rising. 99% graduate. Almost all go to college. They'll earn higher wages, be community involved, more tolerant of diverse views. And the world will be better because of them. Louisiana Catholic schools, in a class of their own.
I'm here today inside historic St. Louis Cathedral, a place where WLAE has broadcast the daily Mass for more than 25 years.
A recent PBS ruling ensures that this valuable service will continue on WLAE for those looking for daily inspiration, and for the many who are homebound or in our area hospitals who can't attend Mass. But in order to continue to provide the Mass every day, we need your financial support now more than ever. I'm asking you to please consider donating today. We have numerous partnership opportunities available. For as little as $32 a month, you can help fund the televising of the Daily Mass, a program that lifts the spirit and enriches the lives of so many of our viewers. And for a donation of $50 or more, we will send you this beautiful signed poster of St. Louis Cathedral as our gift. Please send your contributions to WLAE TV, 3330 North Causeway Boulevard, Metairie, Louisiana, 7002. Or to donate online, log on to WLAE.com and click on the picture of St. Louis Cathedral. For more information on partnership opportunities, call 504-866-7411.
At WLAE, we've worked hard to keep the Mass on the air. Now we need your financial support to keep it going. I know that you'll help us if you can. Thank you, and God bless.
This weekend, the Archdiocese of New Orleans will be hosting workshops with Monsignor James Moroni as part of the Archbishop's Year of Renewal. Joining us now by phone is Monsignor Moroni to talk about his plans for the weekend. Thank you so much for being with us.
Sarah, it's a joy to talk to you. I can't wait to be in New Orleans, one of my favorite cities in the whole country.
Well, it is definitely a fun place to be. And this weekend in particular, we have Jazz Fest getting started. So you are going to definitely be here at probably one of the best points in terms of weather and excitement in the city of New Orleans.
Tremendous. I can't wait.
Very good. Well, first, before we get started talking about what you'll be in New Orleans to do this weekend and actually starting tonight, we have worked with The Mass Explained, your book, throughout the Lent season, and we had an extraordinary response from the people who participated in reading and the study groups. Can you tell us how you got started? What was the impetus for writing the book and what you hope to get out of it?
Well, my heart is warmed by the fact that a few people were able to benefit from it. It was really about, I had spent 13 years working at the Bishop's Conference as the Bishop's Chief Liturgical Advisor at the Bishop's Committee on Divine Worship. I was the director of that office. It's the same office, by the way, that Archbishop Amund is presently the chairman of the, he was elected by all the bishops as chairman of that liturgy committee.
That's right.
But so for 13 years I was there, and I was graciously given a sabbatical by my bishop of 6 months, and I went to Assisi to catch up on some writing projects. And it was a wonderful thing living in Assisi, but one publisher at Catholic Book called, and they said, you know, we'd really like you to do a popular introduction to the Mass, kind of like what Father Romano Guardini had done maybe around 60 years ago, as a sort of a popular pastoral guide, something of an old pastor and liturgist sitting around chatting at the end of the day about what the Mass means. Because if the Mass, in fact, is the source and the summit of our entire lives, it's the most important thing for us to talk about. And so it was, you can picture me sitting in an attic apartment in Assisi, just sort of telling the best stories that I could remember about the Mass and reflecting on the wonders that it does in our lives.
Well, and that is, it's been extremely successful, as you and I were talking about off air, but people were truly touched. Mass has become so commonplace in the lives of so many
Indeed.
Catholics. And so...
Sure, you know, in fact, it was with the new translations, as much as people have had to work so hard on catechesis for them and to remember to, with hopefully with a little bit of a sense of humor, not to say the same old words over and again, one of the things that did was remind us that that the Mass is just so exciting and ever new, and it gives us a chance to go back, as Archbishop Amund has now facilitated, a chance to just go back and look at the Mass once again and find, you know, it's sort of like those people in our lives that an old friend who's been your friend for 30 years and you tend to neglect them after a while, and you just take them for granted. And then every once in a while you say, oh, what a wonderful gift I've been given by God. And it's the same with the Mass now, I think.
Oh, definitely. And I think that the people who participated in the study groups were so touched that they wanted to share the information. And some of the things that we were getting feedback in terms of was, I'm buying this for my family for Easter. This was the simplest guide in simple terms. You don't have to be a theologian. And that's sometimes what's missing from our catechesis, especially in the adult level. People who don't have formal training in theology, or it's been a while since they had their last religion class, this book, your
Sure.
book, The Mass Explained, speaks to them specifically.
It does, and you'll make my publisher very happy by what you're saying, but it's absolutely true. I've been a pastor most of my life, and one learns after a while how to teach. I was very privileged the last 5 years. I've spoken in over 110 dioceses to more than 20,000 priests and
Wow.
deacons about the liturgy and about the new translation. I'm now the rector of the seminary at St. John's up here in Boston, and we spend a lot of time as a faculty trying to figure out how can you teach? What that's the whole new evangelization. Mm-hmm. How can we teach in terms that don't sound so highfalutin that nobody knows what you're talking about, but at the same time are the truth? And that you do that through story, you do it through warmth, you do it most of all by loving the people whom you're writing for and speaking to. But what a joy it is just to talk about the Mass, because it's the most important reality in our lives. The Council Fathers tell us it's the place from which every authentic Christian spirit comes. And it's that mountain, the top of the mountain that everything we're doing is heading towards. That's what we'll be doing for a living for all eternity in the kingdom of heaven, God willing, is praising God at the banquet table of the Lamb. So we might as well get ready for it by doing it well now.
That's right. Well, we're very grateful for your input. And you're going to be in New Orleans starting tonight, actually, at St. Anselm on the North Shore. But on Saturday, you are doing a workshop here on the South Shore at St. Dominic. What are the themes of this workshop for our viewers who might want to participate?
Well, we have 2 hours together, and during the first presentation, I'm going to be talking about the notion of participation in the sacred liturgy. You know, it's the... The Council Fathers said way back there 50 years ago this year that full conscious and active participation in the liturgy was the goal to be considered before all others in the liturgical reform. Well, that kind of participation we've come to realize more and more through the teaching of Blessed John Paul II and Pope Benedict XVI is not just on the outside. It's not just are you singing at the right time, are you standing and sitting, are you walking in the right place. It really is a matter of the heart, and it's a matter of joining our heart to the cross of Christ, of giving ourselves fully and consciously and actively, our mind, our soul, our bodies, our whole lives, to place them upon that altar with the sacrifice of Christ. So we'll be exploring that a little bit. And then in the second talk, we're going to be looking at some of those prayers that may have been driving us crazy as we were learning new translations over the last 5-6 months.
Sure.
And in those new translations, we'll find out that there is an ancient root to those, that there's a meaning that has to do with how we offer the sacrifice of our lives along with the sacrifice of Christ. So it'll be an awful lot of fun. I'm looking forward to it.
Well, and I think it's going to be a lot of fun, and I'm hoping our viewers who are hearing from you now can get excited and get registered, because it is a unique opportunity. Because again, people, as you mentioned, struggling with the new translation, people are like, this isn't how we
sure.
speak. This isn't. These aren't words that we use. This isn't phrasing that we use. It's uncommon. It's uncomfortable. But I think what mm-hmm. you said about it being rooted in sacred and in sacred history is so important mm. for us to realize as Catholics.
Absolutely. It's a the Roman Catholic Church is the only church in the entire world that does liturgy by translation, in which we and what that does is it means that most of the time we are praying the same prayers that have been prayed for the last 2,000 years. When the priest says the opening prayer at Mass this Sunday, it's the same prayer that was heard by St. Francis and St. Clare, by St. Dominic, by little Tommy Aquinas when he made his first communion, by all of the saints throughout all of history. And we're made one with each one of them and with the angels in heaven and with everybody in every time and space. The same prayers are prayed in every Catholic church in different languages, different tongues, by all kinds of different people. But the one thing that weaves us together is the prayer of the church, is this sacrifice of praise we offer to God.
Well, Monsignor Moroni, I think that's an excellent way to close, to really allow us to realize the universality of the church, of the Catholic Church, and that we are a part of that communion of saints, especially and most poignantly as we participate in the Mass.
Indeed.
Well, thank you.
So I'll look forward to seeing you in New Orleans, I hope, Sarah, in just a little while.
Very good. Well, thank you. We are always very welcome. You are always very welcome to be here with us. And if we can ever do anything for you here at Issues in Faith, again, we'll be happy to help.
Excellent. I'll see you soon. Thanks, Sarah.
Thank you, Monsignor. And for our viewers, you can find out more information about the workshops on the Archdiocesan website at www.archdiocese-no.org. And books, The Mass Explained, are still available through the Office of Worship by calling 504-861-6200. We'll be right back.
We never forget our best teachers, the ones who do so much more than teach. They inspire and insist we bring our best in everything we do. We find those mentors in our Catholic schools. It's why Catholic school graduates consistently go on to college, land better jobs, embrace faith, and lead. Louisiana Catholic Schools, in a class of their own.
It's been 25 years since Pope John Paul II made his trip to New Orleans, a visit that took over the city and warmed the hearts of so many here. Now plans are in the works for another kind of visit, one that will give everyone a chance to get to know the man who was called the People's Pope. Janet Gross has the story.
I'm here to say today and to announce formally that he's coming back, but in a different way, but he is coming back.
Next year, a new exhibit featuring the blessed Pope John Paul II is coming to New Orleans.
He still has things to say. He still has things to communicate to all of us. His presence now in heaven. But these words, I have come to you again, were the last words he said right before he died.
Filled with art and items from his personal life, the things on display open a window into his world.
It's an opportunity to be connected again with him and to really go through his life from childhood to his ministry as the Pope and into his death.
A crucifix, a hand drawing, pictures of his funeral where a mighty wind ruffled the many cardinals seated behind his casket.
We'll have his mass kit that he would take out when he would go camping, backpack, like Archbishop has skis. When we get into the childhood area, we'll have some of his childhood clothes, the crib that he was actually in.
New Orleans is the first U.S. stop for the exhibit. It will be housed in the Notre Dame Seminary next February through early May. Hundreds of thousands are expected to visit, and with their ticket, each will receive a special medallion that Pope John Paul blessed before his death.
I didn't know but where the bullet that was left in the Jeep that he was in that went through him. Where it is today, where it's been placed today. So that's, but I'll save some things for the future.
Until the exhibit opens, each month there will be new revelations of what's going to be on display, things of historic and religious significance.
Realizing that he was near death, those in the Vatican wanted to make sure that we had first-class relics. And so there is a vial of his blood that was taken out at that time. And we're very happy to say and privileged and humbled to be able to say that that vial of blood, which is a first-class relic, will be here in the Archdiocese of New Orleans. And this is a picture of two of the sisters who are putting the vial of blood up as a first-class relic.
This exhibition is being put together specifically for the U.S. It will go from here to Seattle to Washington, D.C.
But my permission from Rome and His Holiness is to bring art and things to people who could not afford it or could not see it or could not enjoy or participate in it.
And the timing is significant, says the Archbishop, because Pope Benedict XVI says 2013 will be a year of faith and evangelism.
John Paul II often said by his words, but more importantly by his actions, that he did not believe that people should have to go to the Vatican to visit the Pope. And so he became a missionary Pope who visited the world. Isn't it interesting that even in his death, he's still a missionary Pope who is visiting the world and calling people to faith, awakening that sense of evangelization?
The exhibit is expected to draw visitors from several southern states, Catholics and non-Catholics, who want to know more about the man known as the People's Pope. I'm Janet Gross for Issues and Faith.
The Archbishop is asking for prayers, visitors, and volunteers for the exhibition. They're going to need a couple hundred volunteers. Admission for children will be free, and adult tickets are expected to cost around $8.
If you have a question for us or have an idea for a story you'd like to see on air, write to us at Issues in Faith, 3330 North Causeway Boulevard, Suite 345, Metairie, Louisiana, 70002, or email us at questions@wlae.com. Plus, if you miss an episode, you can catch up online at www.archdiocese-no.org. And that's our program for this evening. For all of us at Issues in Faith, thanks for watching.
We'll be back next week. Hope you join us again soon. Until then, God bless.